And Professor, of course, a lot of expectations now with this particular visit. What's that one thing that Kenya can do to take advantage of the UK exiting the EU?
I think they should craft a free trade agreement with the UK immediately, which is as good or as preferential as the one that Kenya now enjoys with the EU. I think it's not actually going to be a matter of taking advantage. It's going to be a matter of necessity to keep as good trading deal terms as we have with the rest of the EU under the existing EPAs, Economic Partnership Agreements.
Correct.
We need to do that. If we don't do that, then we could lose a lot. So immediately it's to take advantage and have an FTA.
All right. Yeah. And of course, still staying with this, having an FTA in an environment where we've seen various other economic blocs across West Africa, SADC, and now EAC, one of the biggest challenges is we are yet to see commitment from some member countries who have yet to validate these EPAs. Yeah. And what way forward? Should Kenya perhaps consider other options?
Well, I think Kenya is different because even with the trade agreements that have stalled in other places, I mean, an EPA is one example. Kenya has actually been on the front line. Kenya ratified its EPA a long time ago because Kenya understands the market share and market interest that we have.
Mm.
I have no doubt that Kenya would be very quick to, Kenya and the UK would be very quick to work on a, it would not be one that would be agreed upon then not ratified.
All right.
Because we've got a lot to lose if we don't sign one. And I'm sure the UK would, it would be in the UK's interest as well to make that deal with Kenya.
All right. Maurice, just let me allow you to also weigh in on this in terms of what can we quickly say are the low-hanging fruits out of this visit?
Because if you look at the current ongoing discussion about Brexit, look at the trading pattern between Kenya and the European Union and Kenya and other economic blocs, the major trading partner for Kenya still remain the European Union and the entire European Union, plus also the Britain included.
Sure.
What Kenya should ensure that at least the worst case scenario, we should get the best deal that we still have with the European Union.
Mm.
The best case scenario, we can take advantage of it and utilize it as much as possible. But we should ensure that at least until, as in the major market for our exports still remains Europe, and again, we should enhance that with the negotiation with Britain. The major trading block for most of our agricultural products from Kenya still remains Europe, and we should ensure that at least the worst case scenario, we were where we were with the European Union. But the best case scenario, we push it even though that we benefit beyond that.
All right. Yeah. And Prof, many say that it's a strategic visit. We've seen German Chancellor, that is Angela Merkel, is in Senegal. The other day, President Uhuru Kenyatta was in the United States with Donald Trump, U.S. President. Now we're having the UK Prime Minister coming to the country, and increasingly Africa is becoming a very important destination for the superpowers.
Yeah, it's very lucrative. It's a very lucrative place, and I think what is happening is that we've got the Chinese are forced very quietly a form of structural change in how important Africa is seen by other players in two ways. One is trade, but the other one is in terms of debt. So Africa is a big consumer of debt, and other countries, particularly the United States, would like to get into that market, if you will, of lending money. It's a way not only of assisting, but it's a different way of assisting in the sense that it's not the ODA kind of assistance that traditionally has been going on.
Correct.
So you change from ODA to giving soft loans, which also actually are very attractive because they give the lenders a bit more political influence over the countries that are borrowing money. Mm-hmm. So the United Kingdom, I think, might want to get into that, but particularly the US might want to get into that.
All right.
I think the other thing, and which is something that Donald Trump highlighted, was the United States would also like to set up an example, this road that they want to build, the Mombasa Road.
Yes.
So that it's not seen that China is the only model we can follow. Yeah. So let's have Americans building roads and let's see what they are like.
So are you saying the cake is big enough?
The cake is big enough, at least for us. I think the question is not perhaps of the cake being big or small enough. Mm-hmm. It's a question of how can we leverage on the interest. Yeah. Different countries are offering different things.
Sure.
I don't know if the figures you gave here are right about China, for instance, but China is giving us a lot of loans mm-hmm. and FDI. But China is not playing as big a role in terms of trade. We are not exporting massively to China.
Sure.
So I think the question for us with regards to China is, what are you going to do about trade? And it's easy because we've got a very good model that has been given by the United States. Our trade balance with the United States is actually very good. So they are buying as much as we are buying from them. And most, the reason for that is mostly AGOA, textile exports.
Sure.
So why not craft some sort of an AGOA with China mm-hmm. With regards to export of what we are doing. Mm-hmm. So with China, we need to work more on trade. With the US, we need to work more on the investment because they can do that. Their trade, I think, is they're doing fine. And of course, the loans. With the UK, I think the interest is a little bit different. I doubt they can match major powers in terms of the money that they're going to give us in terms of loans, but they can do a lot in terms of investment. I think the UK can see that the banking industry is changing. We've mm-hmm. got a lot of interest in financial technology, and UK firms have been on the forefront, the Barclays and Standard Chartered and so on. So what the UK companies can do, and Kenya has been good in things like M-Pesa, so I think UK companies have got a good advantage as Kenya, and Kenyan companies as well,
right,
in leveraging on partnerships in fintech and
right,
promoting Nairobi and Kenya as a center for financial technology, money transfer and things like mm-hmm. that.
Interesting yeah. insights. And of course, you touched extensively about China.
Yeah.
We'll be talking more about FOCAC summit also. And for you, Maurice, Theresa May is very particular, saying that she is keen to grow investments in Africa. She has a war chest of about £4 billion. This translates to something in the region of 400 billion Kenyan shillings that will be targeting Nigeria, South Africa, and Kenya. And as Professor mentioned, there are so many areas that the UK already has interests in Kenya, from technology to the banking industry. And of course, they're really keen on solar power as well.
If you look at the renewed interest in Africa as a continent, it just, to historians, remind us the scramble on partition for Africa, but this time the interest is a little bit different. Because if you look at major economic blocks, even the economic growth projection, Africa is still projected again to grow rapidly. Mm-hmm. If you look at even demographic, Africa still is very attractive. If you look at even the area that still have the infrastructure development needs, is Africa. Area that still need financial support is Africa. If you go to Europe, they're operating a negative interest rate. Where could they take this money? Mm-hmm. They lend to Africa. So, and now you look at the major economic partners, look at China. China have totally changed the dimension in terms of people supposed to do business with Africa. Look at even the renewed interest from the US. Look at even now Germany is now showing interest. Look at even Britain, now Theresa May is in Kenya. In fact, all of these people over the last week, at least they have met African leaders. And if you look at all this, Africa as a continent, what they are supposed now to do is supposed now to ensure that at least they benefit from this. The benefit of that now they get preferential treatment in terms of how they are getting loans, prefer they get more advanced technology in terms of infrastructural development, mm-hmm. so that at the end of the day they live, they benefit from all this interest. If you look at the renewed interest in terms of banking, you've seen again most European banks, especially banks with roots in the Britain, sort of like they are now coming out of Africa. But if you again look at now the performance of the banking sector and financial sector industry, Africa still has better opportunities compared to major economies in the world.
All
and
right.
the interest in Africa is in South Africa. Look at Nigeria, a country that controls more than a quarter of the sub-Saharan African economy.
Mm.
You look at Kenya, again, a country growing at about between 5.5, almost heading to 6%. So all these new interests are now, they just want to see that apart from now working with Africa, how can they also benefit?
All right.
But seeing Africans, if they position themselves properly, they are likely to benefit more than even the European, Europe and also America and also the likes of Britain and Germany.
Interesting. And of course, Maurice, to avoid being in a position where it's an exploitative kind of a situation, Theresa May did mention that she wants to see a mutual beneficial kind of arrangement out of the trade between Kenya and the United Kingdom. But to take the conversation forward, Maurice, one of the big interests that many Kenyans are having right now is repatriation of assets, especially that when it comes to corruption. And this is something that the PM, Prime Minister, was very specific on, saying that they will work hand in hand with Kenya towards addressing this. How big a volume is proceeds coming through if this is to be implemented?
In fact, if you look at this, and if you look at now the renewed war against corruption, if you look at most countries that usually have tax havens, they are mainly around Europe and mainly some parts of the US. If we utilize this renewed interest of the partnership properly, we are likely to recover most of the assets that were taken illegally outside the country, most of the public funds that were missed, that are taken some tax havens. But in totality, again, to Kenya and also to Africa and most African countries, the question still remains, even after the recovery, how will you use these recovered resources for the benefits of all Kenyans?
All right.
Not just recovery for recovery's sake, it's recovery for the benefits of all Kenyans.
All right, I see Professor just itching to respond.
I'm just wondering,
as we wrap up,
why they actually brought it publicly. Because if you have half a billion of corruption money in Kenyan shillings, then now you know that you will not take it to the UK. I mean, they could do it. I think there was a minister from Nigeria whose assets were confiscated, but I'm doubtful that it'll yield much.
All right.
Yeah.
Gentlemen, we have to bring it to a close at that point.